Grace, mercy, and peace are yours in abundance from God our Lord and Savior, Christ Jesus. Our text for our meditation this morning is taken from the prophet Joel, chapter 2, verses 28 and 29. And afterward, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. So far, text. Your Christian friends, everything changed. In 2001, on September 11th, nothing was the same. Those images are burnt into our minds. You don't need to go watch the movie because you lived it. Well, some of you. Some of you are too young to remember. I'm dating myself, but after 14 years here, do you remember that day? If you're really little and you don't, it might behoove you to go onto YouTube and watch a few videos just to understand what was going through. When I crowded into my counselor's office on a little black and white TV, we don't even have those anymore, and I watched it happen over and over again. The whole nation was kind of in a funk for like 3 days at least. Kind of couldn't believe that it happened. Everything changed. Protocol. Well, it's not just 9/11 that changes everything. I think if you've ever held one of those for the first time and it's your first child, everything changes. Everything changes because instantly you're not interested in roller coasters. You're interested in seeing your small child visit Tigger for the first time. You can't explain it. You can't even It's hard to describe how everything changes. The prophet Joel is talking about the day of the Lord. This is a common theme that runs through the whole Old Testament. And this day of the Lord would change everything. It doesn't have to be 9/11, but it probably was the birth of a baby. The baby Jesus. You see, there's this prophetic perspective that runs through all of the Old Testament prophets. It gets smushed together. We're going to talk about it more at the end. And yet this day of the Lord would be incredible. It would change things. And in all honesty, as you look at the fulfillments that go through the history of the world, there's been more than one. The birth of our Savior was definitely a day of the Lord. Pentecost was another, as Joel foretold it. And Peter lived it. We're going to talk about all of these things a little bit more as we see Pentecost and how it was, in fact, a day of the Lord. Pentecost was a fascinating time. It was a harvest festival. You see, God's Old Testament people for thousands of years went out to the fields and they got in the first fruits, those first grains, whatever it might have been, the first watermelon, whatever you like. And they would put it on their kitchen table and they would not eat it. They would take it to their Lord and they would give it to Him. This was important for a couple reasons. Number one, Lord, I give you the best. I give you the first. And even though I'm hungry, I don't need to eat this. You know why? Because my God will give me more. It was a statement of faith that our God is so good that I'm going to give Him back just a hair of what He's given to me. You cannot outgive the giver. This is true of stewardship in general, with all of our time, talents, and treasures. And the Jews got it. They understood it. And Pentecost was a festival surrounding this. Well, on that first Pentecost, God gave them more. But this wasn't just a harvest of grain. This was a harvest of souls. On that first Pentecost, well, 2,000 souls were added to the church on that day. And that New Testament church grew like wildfire. And the power of the Spirit was with the disciples. And again, as you saw in the lessons, that power wasn't in the wind. It wasn't in the flames above their heads. It wasn't even in the languages that they spoke. The power was with the gospel that turned hearts, 2,000 of them that day. The power was that people could forgive. The power Well, that same power still exists today. Many of you have seen it. As you've shared it with the people around you, as you've lived it in your own lives, as you've been able to forgive the people around you. That's incredible power. And that's one example of the day of the Lord. Now, if you were one of the enemies of the Jews, and you heard that there was a king born, and let's say that you didn't know what this king was going to do, this would be a very bad thing, right? You think that the Messiah is going to come and he's going to ransack all the other nations. He's going to rule with an iron scepter. All those promises from Christmas all the way through. Well, Jesus wasn't exactly like that, was he? If you were the Jews, on the other hand, you thought, great, he finally came. Get out that iron scepter, start bashing heads, Jesus. But then he didn't do it. Because the prophet Joel had everything kind of smushed together in one vision. They didn't get it. They weren't looking necessarily for the halfway in between. They just wanted to fast forward to the end of time. We'll get to that later in the sermon, of course. But let's hear these words one more time. And afterward. The Apostle Peter, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, takes those words, and you heard it in the book of Acts, and he says, in these last days. The Apostle Peter ushered in the season of end times on Pentecost. Everything had been fulfilled. The world can end now. In these last days. Well, there's a couple other things Jesus mentioned in Matthew 24. Jerusalem hadn't been ransacked. That happened a few years after that. But by now, they're all done. If Christ comes on the way home, don't be surprised. It's true. In these last days, Prophet Joel says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. What does that look like? Well, if you're the prophet Joel, that was common. The Holy Spirit came on someone and they prophesied. Just like Joel did. The Old Testament's full of prophets, minor and the big ones who wrote ginormous volumes. Isaiah, Ezekiel. Plenty in there from these guys. Well, Joel looked ahead to the New Testament church, and what do you think he saw in 2017? How many Christian churches that are part of the Holy Christian Church, not necessarily in our fellowship, but Christians, who are prophesying in Jesus' name just like I am now? That probably blew Joel's mind to imagine that there are that many people. He saw in Roanoke yesterday how our Savior's Lutheran Church went out with the gospel. There's a new program called Praise and Proclaim. Doesn't really matter. They trained the members to go out, and 85 witnesses were made to people in the community for Jesus. The gospel was shared that many times. That's what Joel saw. And it still happens every time you do the exact same thing. It's pretty cool. There are other examples, of course, if you want the classic dreams. What about Joseph? My kids just saw the musical for the first time. Is that a children's theater here in Winston-Salem? Joseph had dreams, right? And his dreams saved not just the nation of Egypt, but they saved God's people. You go to, Daniel. Daniel was in exile, and yet he saw visions of what would come for all the nations and the ones that would rise and fall. He saw Rome, and he finally saw Jesus. You go to King David into the Psalms, and David saw Jesus hanging on the cross. When you look at some of those Psalms, we've gone through a sermon series or two of those in Lent. And then you, of course, Isaiah in 53. It's as if he's standing there. Those are classic examples of those dreams, and yet the prophecies that we give, even though they often just parrot what was said, aren't wrong, and they're not bad. And the Holy Spirit uses the Word of God, and changes hearts. It has spread like wildfire around the globe, and it does so still today. Well, that picture is interesting. If you look at the idea of the images that are here, you can compare prophets and priests. What does, do you know how Peter describes you? We've gone through this. 2 weeks ago, we talked about how you are a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you might declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. He calls you a nation of priests. Okay? What does that mean? How many of you have gone up to this altar and slaughtered a bullock? That'd be kind of bloody, right? We don't do that anymore. Your sacrifices are different, but you're still a nation of priests. The sacrifices you offer to God are, well, song, I suppose, is pretty easy, but it goes into every thought, word, and deed that you do out of thanks for your Lord. Driving the speed limit, not returning a harsh word in kind, being faithful with the gifts he's given you in your work, in school. Those are sacrifices, my fellow nation of priests. That's who you are. And prophets? Well, of course, you prophesy. And here is the proof, Isaiah chapter 8, to the law and to the testimony. If they do not speak according to this word, they have no light of dawn. God warned people, don't mess around with my word. You go back to it and you stay there. That's it. Don't go off the reservation. I had a neighbor, and he asked me, Pastor Fred, you believe in the Holy Spirit? Yeah, I do. No problem with that. How long did the Spirit move you to speak? Well, that's usually when I just stop. Because I don't like going off on just what Fred thinks. I like sharing with you what God says. I think that's all that really matters. Because I have some really great thoughts on a lot of topics. But they don't matter. Not compared to what my God says. And so we go back to Him in His Word. And finally, if you look at the Gospel of Luke and you have the example of the rich man and Lazarus, the rich man, well, he died and he went to hell. And he was in agony. And he asked that prophets would go back from the dead and talk to his brothers because he didn't want them to have the same fate. And do you know what was told to him? They have Moses and the prophets. If they don't listen to them, they will not change their mind. Even if someone rises from the dead. That's important for two reasons. First of all, Jesus rose from the dead, and they didn't care. When you share with someone your faith, you don't need proof. You don't need miracles. You don't need any of that. All you need is God's word, and the Spirit goes with it, and acts in power to change hearts. That's all you need. All right, listen to verse 29. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. Now, what Joel is saying here, he's not nullifying the different roles that we have in life as men and women. He's not saying that there's no differences at all. We hear the Apostle Paul say something very similar in Galatians. For there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. You don't need to bristle or ignore the roles that God has given you. If you look at a football team, I don't think any of the linemen really wish they could throw the football. They don't want to. They want to shove the guy in front of them backwards. That's it. There are a lot of you who never ever want to stand in my shoes because it'd be terrifying to stand in front of people every Sunday. I don't want some of your jobs because I don't know that I could do them. Okay? Whatever God's gifts He has given you, use them faithfully and joyfully. See where God has placed you and serve there. Now, what about the rest of this? I'm going to keep on reading, and we're going to go back to the day of the Lord. Listen to verse 30. I will show wonders in the heavens and on earth, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Joel, what did you see there, buddy? Well, he saw Pentecost. Peter says so. But he also saw an F4 tornado rip through East Texas on April 29th. What else did he see? Volcanoes? Did he see the actual end of the world? Did he see hurricanes? I don't know what terrible things Joel actually saw in his vision, and as the Spirit inspires him to write them down, he sees everything, and it's all smushed together. This is prophetic perspective. And so when you read these words in the Bible, you don't need to be fearful about what's coming because you know that this must happen. One day the world will end, and you can look forward to its coming. Because when it does, you won't have to worry about your next colonoscopy. I haven't had one yet. I'll be 41 in May. I know it's coming. Because God will end it and take me home and give me a glorified body that won't have any problems at all. Dear friends, the day of the Lord is something that you can look forward to. It's not necessarily something bad. And a lot of it depends on who you are. If you are someone who's not a believer, do you think they look forward to the end of the world? It's probably a bad idea. Because all they know is what we have here. You're different. This is not your home. You can look forward to something far better that your God has planned for you. And that's the heaven. Last Sunday we celebrated Ascension. And Jesus will return on the last day to take you home to be with Him. But you're not there yet. In the meantime, enjoy the power of the Spirit that He's given you and use it. Use it boldly as He enables you. Speak to your friends and your neighbors and your co-workers about your God. And it's exciting to see how He convicts the world. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. We now confess our Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed, found in your worship folder. In a world that has difficulty believing in the one true God, but is so ready to believe that our universe happened by some unknown accident,